no hard feelings, none whatsoever. Yeah, that, no, not even a joke. I'm not kidding. We're all here because Jesus is that good. So let's stand and sing this one. Amen. 2, 3.
Blessing and honor, glory and power be to the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days. Heaven and heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne in worship. You be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days.
Say that again.
Blessing and honor, glory and power be to the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days. Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne in worship. You be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days.
let them be taken in the devices that they have imagined. For the wicked boasts of his heart's desire, and blesses the covetous, whom the Lord abhorreth. The wicked, through the pride of his countenance, will not seek after God. God is not in all his thoughts. His ways are always grievous. Thy judgments are far above out of his sight. As for all his enemies, he puffeth at them. He has said in his heart, I shall not be moved, for I shall never be an adversary. His mouth is full of cursing and deceit and fraud. Under his tongue is mischief and vanity. He sitteth in the lurking places of the villages. In the secret places doth he murder the innocent. His eyes are firmly set against the poor. He lieth in wait secretly as a lion in his den. He lieth in wait to catch the poor. He doth catch the poor when he draweth him into his net. He croucheth and humbleth himself that the poor may fall by his strong ones. He hath said in his heart, God hath forgotten. He hideth his face. He will never see it. Arise, O Lord, O God, lift up thine hand. Forget not the humble. Wherefore doth the wicked tempt God? He hath said in his heart, Thou wilt not require it. Thou hast seen it, for thou beholdeth mischief, and spite shall requite it with thy hand. The poor committeth himself unto thee. Thou art the helper of the fatherless. Break thou the arm of the wicked and the evil man. Seek out the wickedness till thou find none. The Lord is king forever and ever. The heathen are perished out of his sight. Lord, thou hast heard the desire of the humble. Thou wilt prepare their heart. Thou wilt cause thine ear to hear, to judge the fatherless and the oppressed, that the man of the earth may no more oppress.
Praise thy faithfulness, O God.
there's a mercy, I just feel led in this moment. If there's a mercy that you see this morning, share that with us. Yes.
It was such a blessing to see my brother-in-law in Harrisville, Tennessee. And my sister died 36 years ago. And it was before Facebook and cell phones. We kind of lost touch, but we've met back up with him and his family. And it was such a joyous time. And he rebelled for a while, but he's living strongly for the Lord now. And it was, the Lord was so present. It was just such a blessing.
I just want to pray the Lord save me. I haven't been able to even go to a grocery store. And I haven't had people to tell me about and I'll go get my groceries for me. And this week the Lord just me to go out and go shopping. That is these things so much that people have to be. When you know your Jesus is there lifting you up and taking you to the grocery store, eating out of groceries. I just pray him for everything he does for me. Even when he's with me, I believe in him, he's still with me.
There are times we take those things for granted, those mercies that he shows us each and every day. Maybe we shouldn't. Maybe we should recognize that he's a friend to us, that he longs to desire to be with us and in the midst of us, and wants us to have that same desire to be with him in his word and in prayer. Yeah, Miss Cindy. It's an amazing thing when we are able, in the midst of our circumstances, trying circumstances, troubling circumstances, to still be able to see his mercy. Because he's still merciful. And all that is a realization that where our focus actually lies, whether it's on the temporal things, these temporary things of this life, or whether it's on those eternal things that he gifts us with. And if we can ever begin to trade those things, if we can trade those aspects of our lives, if we can trade our lives for his mercies and for his friendship, for a relationship with him, that's when we really see those new mercies every day. Not just in the morning, but in the evening and in the afternoon and a couple of times each night and a couple of times each day and maybe, you know, thousands more as we continue to live through this life looking toward with the hope of the next. Amen. Thank you for your encouragement this morning. I think we all needed it.
one more time?
Can we do that, please? I'm really counting on Riley to help us this time. Y'all ready? One, two. Good morning.
Good morning!
Hey! There we go. I have a question. Have any of y'all ever been sick?
Yes.
No? Any of you recently?
No.
No? Miss Lisa has. She's been battling the flu, but she's better now, praise God. Amber, when you were sick, what was wrong? Yeah, that's terrible. That's a really uncomfortable thing. How about it? When you're sick, you keep throwing up. Sometimes. Who else? Yes, ma'am? So let me ask you this question. When we are sick, what do mom and dad, or maybe grandma and grandpa do?
Make
you what? They give you medicine. They make you go to sleep. Right? They take you to school, or they let you skip school. What'd you say? They take you to school, whether you're sick or not, you're there. Yeah. Does anybody's parents take them to the doctor? There we go. Yeah. Now, when mom and dad are taking you to the doctor and you're feeling kind of puny, maybe they might pick you up and carry you to the car. Something tells me Riley has to walk himself to the car just by what he said already, so that makes sense too. In our passage of scripture this morning, we're reading about a guy who was sick. But he wasn't sick because he had a runny nose. He wasn't sick because he kept revisiting breakfast. He was sick. He couldn't walk. Bible says he was lame. He was paralyzed from his waist down. He couldn't move. Now, the Bible says in Luke chapter 5 that he had some friends that were worried about him. Matter of fact, it says, let's see where we're going to be. On one of those days while he was teaching, that means when Jesus was teaching, Pharisees and teachers of the law were sitting there who had come from every village of Galilee and Judea and also from Jerusalem. And the Lord's power to heal was in Jesus. Now, if we keep reading, we see that there were some men who came carrying on a mat a man who was paralyzed. They tried to bring him in. They wanted to put him with Jesus. They wanted to set him at Jesus' feet because Jesus had been healing people, right? And so, as his friends, knowing that he couldn't walk to see Jesus himself, they decided they wanted to carry him to Jesus. But they couldn't get to him because the crowd around the house was too large. And so they ended up actually taking this guy outside, up a flight of stairs, taking him to the roof, and then lowering him in through the roof. Before they did that, they broke the roof. Thankfully, it was the type of roof that could be easily repaired, right? That would be very important. So they let this fella come in on his mat through the roof. I would say that's some pretty good friends, wouldn't you? Not only that they would carry the guy, but that they would carry him all the way up onto the roof. Now, Mr. Mike used to work on roofs, and so he knows roofs can be pretty high up there, right? And so if they're carrying this guy up there and then to try to lower him down slowly, that took a lot of strength and a lot of effort, right? They must have really loved him. Well, I have a question. Which one of you wants to lay down on this mat? How about you? Come on. Lay down right here. Now, looking at the group, I just love it how God works things out sometimes. I'm seeing Aaron and Riley over there, and they didn't know that they were coming down front this morning so that they could help me, but they are. So I want to put you on this corner over here. Thank you, Aaron. I appreciate it. Riley, come here. Put you on an opposite corner. That's great. You know you want to help? Come on. The rest of y'all want to help? Let's circle around this mat. Now, here's what I want you to do. We're going to grab the mat. We're going to pick it up. Now, I'm going to ask something of you. Y'all ready? We're going to carry it all the way to the back. We're going to let them see in the back that she's on the mat and everything's good. Mr. Larry's back there. Somebody's got to give him a high five when we get back there. All right, good. Do me a favor, though. When you do that, don't drop her, okay? So maybe just hold on real strong and real quick high five. Yeah, okay. So we're going to go to the back, and then we're going to come back to the front. Hang on. Somebody needs to come around here. I'm not doing it. Somebody needs to come around here. Use those muscles. Braxton, get on here next to Riley. There you go. All right. All the way to the back. So Somebody give Mr. Larry a high five, and then we're coming back. Usually when you see one, you see the other. Kind of like when you see Aaron, you see Riley. Or when you see Braxton, you see Katie. That's kind of how that works, right? So here's what's really cool. I want you all this week to think about how important it is that we be a friend to someone. And just maybe God might use you to be able to lead that person into Jesus' presence. You with me? Track it. Awesome. Mr. Michael's going to pray for us, and we're going to head back to our seats with that.
Thank you so much for these children and Lord. Thank you for giving the strength, Lord, to carry them somewhere around. case you're wondering, that's my niece. I might be a little proud. If you're glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning, would you say amen?
Amen.
It has been a wonderful opportunity for us to gather during Sunday school. How many of you enjoyed your classes? It was a good class. Awesome. Dan Tolliver taught this morning. Don't hold that against Randy. I'm kidding, buddy. You're here. You know, it is what it is. I want to tell you I'm excited this morning for a couple of reasons. One, because I have the opportunity to be here with you all. Two, because while my wife is out of town, my mother-in-law has come into town with her mother, and so they're here. Valerie and Margie are here sitting with me on the front row, in case you're wondering. No, Tiffany does know that another woman is sitting beside me in church. So everything's okay there. But here's the reason that I highlight them this morning. A year ago today, exactly the second Sunday of March last year, was the Sunday that y'all installed me as your pastor. Yeah. And so I'm excited that it's been a year, and it's been a wonderful year together. But a year ago today, we were excited and we were joyful because as a church, we had been praying for my mother-in-law who had spent some time in the ICU at Deaconess Gateway. And so here we are a year later, and I'm here to tell you that thank you because of your prayers. Tiffany's grandmother, Margie, had several strokes a couple of weeks ago, and she is here and she is functioning and she is talking and all is well. And so we're praising God for that as well. When Drew mentioned new mercies we see every day, this is definitely one of them that God would have seen her through a very trying couple of weeks. If you've got a copy of God's Word with you, Luke chapter 5 is where we're going to be. Luke chapter 5, we're going to start in verse 12 in order to get a running start. But as you're finding your place, I want to share with you part of the reason why there's so much excitement in the air today, and that is because of what will be taking place tonight. If you were here last Sunday evening, you know that we spent time together identifying what some needs were in the community of Evansville. Then we spent some time identifying what some of those ministries were, some mission needs were that we could accomplish and that we could actually do well. And then we divided the room into five areas and five teams of mission groups. And so as you all were here Sunday night, you know that we had a team devoted to the United Methodist Youth Home and having a chance to go out to them and spend time with them, sponsoring a game night or a game day. I know that there was a team sitting up close to where my family is, and that was the team going to the villa. And so that team is decided as a group that we would go and do laundry, have an opportunity to share a laundry service with the folks that live there in the villa. And so this afternoon at 3 o'clock, that team will be going out and passing flyers in that community so that they would know that we love them as a church, but more importantly, that Jesus loves them, amen, and that we want to meet their needs as best as we can. There's another team doing some painting and construction and yard work. They are meeting tonight at 5 o'clock to continue their plans and fine-tuning some things. We've got an evangelism team also meeting this afternoon at 5 o'clock. We've got another team that was devoted to children's ministry, and they're going to be going and sharing with our children, not only the children here, but children in our communities, both the Willamette neighborhood and the villa, as we are sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ with children who need to know that there is hope in the midst of a hopeless world. Are you with me this morning? I'm excited. We launch this afternoon. The missions team that went over to the Methodist Youth Home actually, I believe, launched yesterday morning. Is that right? From 11 to 1. Excited to hear how that went. But there is excitement in the air, and I can't help but smile whenever God puts things together. And so y'all know we've been walking through the book of Luke, and you know that in Luke chapter 5, we've been talking about Jesus calling the disciples. That was last week, the first 11 verses, that Jesus would ask Peter to take the boat out into the water after they'd been fishing all night, and that he would have an opportunity to preach to those that were on the shoreline, and then that Jesus would look to Peter and say, go ahead and throw your nets over the side. And Peter says, who are you? We've been fishing all night, and now you want me to throw the nets down again? And Jesus says, yes, do it. And he does. And they catch so many fish that the nets begin to tear. Amen. They bring a friend's boat over, and they load the fish into the boat so much that the boats begin to have trouble staying afloat. And in that moment, those men see that Jesus is special, that Jesus is fully God, yet fully man. And those men, when they get back to shore, the scripture says immediately they left everything and followed him. And so this morning, picking up in verse 12, as we're kind of finishing the story, or continuing the story rather, I am not going to ask you to stand yet as I read verses 12 through 16, but I will ask you to stand in just a moment, so stay tuned. Luke chapter 5, beginning in verse 12. While he was in one of the towns, a man was there who had a serious skin disease all over him. He saw Jesus, fell face down, and begged him, "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean." Reaching out his hand, he touched him, saying, "I am willing. Be made clean." And immediately the disease left him. Then he ordered him to tell no one, but "Go and show yourself to the priest," Jesus said, "and offer what Moses prescribed for your cleansing as a testimony to them." But the news about Jesus spread even more, and large crowds would come together to hear him and to be healed of their sicknesses. Yet he often withdrew to deserted places and prayed. Would you stand with me in the honor of reading God's word, picking up in verse 17, reading through to verse 26. On one of those days while he was teaching, Pharisees and teachers of the law were sitting there who had come from every village of Galilee and Judea and also from Jerusalem. And the Lord's power to heal was in Jesus. Just then some men came carrying on a mat a man who was paralyzed. They tried to bring him in and set him down before Jesus. Since they could not find a way to bring him in because of the crowd, they went up on the roof and lowered him on the mat through the roof tiles into the middle of the crowd before Jesus. Seeing their faith, he said, "Friend, your sins are forgiven you." Then the scribes and the Pharisees began to think, "Who is this man who speaks blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone?" But perceiving their thoughts, Jesus replied to them, "Why are you thinking this in your hearts? Which is easier to say, 'Your sins are forgiven you,' or to say, 'Get up and walk'? But so you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins," he told the paralyzed man, "I tell you, get up, pick up your mat, and go home." Immediately, there's that word again, he got up before them, picked up what he had been lying on, and went home glorifying God. Then everyone was astounded or astonished, and they were giving glory to God. And they were filled with awe and said, "We have seen incredible things today." Bow your heads with me. Father, what a privilege it is to come into your house, to gather with fellow brothers and sisters in Christ, and to spend time in your word. Father, I thank you for the children. The ones who very innocently come every Sunday morning, trusting that they will hear a word. And so, Lord, I pray for our Sunday school teachers that are speaking to their lives every week. Lord, thank you for their devotion. Thank you for the hard work that they put into preparing lessons. Thank you for giving in them a desire to see children's lives saved, children coming to Christ, as we will be celebrating in just a couple of weeks, as Braden mentioned. Lord, I do thank you for the truth of your word. I thank you for the message that you have given me this morning. And I pray that as we walk through this passage together, Lord, that the message that we hear would come directly from you without any mixture of opinion from me. And I'll be very careful to give you any honor or glory that might come this way. And it is in Christ's name that all God's people said. Amen. Would you be seated, please? In an article for Guidepost Magazine, D.C. Egner wrote this: "Whenever I read the story of the paralyzed man who was healed by Jesus, I think about his friends. They cared enough about him to take him to Jesus. Kelly, a college student, shattered her arm in the first volleyball game of the season. And this meant that she couldn't work at her part-time job. And before long, her car actually stopped running. And to top it all off, the young man that she had been dating stopped calling her altogether. Kelly felt so low that she began spending hours alone in her dorm room crying. But Laura, a Christian friend on the volleyball team, became concerned about Kelly and decided to help her. So she called some friends and they planned a party. They collected some money and a couple of fellas got her car up and running, and then they found a temporary job that she could do using just one hand, and they even got her tickets to see her basketball hero Isaiah Thomas when the Detroit Pistons came to town. But before long, Kelly was herself again. And when she asked why they did all of this for her, Laura was able to tell her about the love of Jesus. Having a friend in need, Egner writes, is an opportunity to show the love of Christ in deeds and then in words. And we never know what mighty things God can do with a small act of kindness. a small act of kindness. I smile, and I said this earlier, I love it when God puts together the big things and the little things. And this morning, what more appropriate passage of Scripture to be studying than one about friends sharing the gospel with others, taking a friend with them to see Jesus as we are preparing to go into our community and share the gospel and to meet needs. I love it when God works the small things out for His glory. Amen. Look with me at verse 17. On one of those days while he was teaching, Pharisees and teachers of the law were sitting there who had come from every village of Galilee and Judea and also from Jerusalem, and the Lord's power to heal was in him, that is Jesus. Just then, some men came carrying on a mat a man who was paralyzed, and they tried to bring him in and set him down before him. Now, picture this for me for just a minute. There are a couple of different storylines that take place in this passage of Scripture, and if you look at this first one, you see these friends. We know that they had love for this man. We know that they were obviously friends because who else would take the time to pick a man up and carry him to meet Jesus? You with me? Not just that they would carry him to meet Jesus, but when they got to the house where Jesus was, the crowd was so large that they couldn't get in the door. I can't help but wonder if many of us, including myself, would have said, man, we got you this close, set him down and gone home. Like, that's a long way to carry somebody to get to the door and say, we can't get in. But no, these guys said something else. They said, we're going to get him to Jesus no matter what. You hear me? No matter what. And so they carry him up to the roof. And we know, according to the building codes of the day, smile, it's church, there were no building codes, but we know according to the way that they built homes back then, that it would have been easy for them to pull the ceramic tiles off of the roof, to lower this man in, and to drop him at the feet of Jesus. Keep reading with me, I'm in verse 19. Since they couldn't find a way to bring him in because of the crowd, they went up to the roof and lowered him on the mat, threw the roof tiles into the middle of the crowd before Jesus. Seeing their faith, he said, friend, your sins are forgiven you. Storyline number one, plot line if you could. We have four friends who care about another friend enough to do whatever it took to get him to Jesus. That's awesome. That's a sermon in and of itself, and we'll get there. But then the second storyline comes into play with what Jesus has to say. Notice again. Friend, your sins are forgiven you. Keep reading in verse 21. Then the scribes and the Pharisees began to think, who is this man who speaks blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone? But perceiving their thoughts, Jesus replied to them, why are you thinking this in your heart? Which is easier, to say your sins are forgiven you, or to say get up and walk? But so you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he told the paralyzed man, I tell you, get up, pick up your mat, and go home. We're beginning to see the rub that comes into play between Jesus and the religious elites. The Pharisees are there. Now, why were they there? It's a good question to ask. Could it be that they were there because they wanted to hear what Jesus had to say? That would be logical. Were they there because they heard about him and wanted to see what he was really all about? I would go there too. But I would also argue that some of them were there because they had heard some of the things that had been going on. They wanted to be where he was so that they could see for themselves whether or not this man really was doing these things that they had been hearing. Notice they came from Jerusalem, from Judea, and from Galilee, from all over. And they came to hear and to see what Jesus had to say and what Jesus was doing. They weren't happy. Jesus, being incarnate, had the ability to heal the man's sins, and that's exactly what he does, but by doing so, he ruffles the feathers of the religious experts in the room. They know that only God can forgive sin, and they begin thinking that Jesus had committed a blasphemy, some sort of blasphemy, an offense even punishable by death. But even given those two storylines, I believe that the crux of the message is found in verses 22 through 24. I've read it three times, I'll read it a fourth. Perceiving their thoughts, Jesus replied to them, why are you thinking this in your hearts? Which is easier, to say your sins are forgiven you, or to say get up and walk? But so you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he told the paralyzed man, I tell you, get up and walk. take your mat, go home. When we started our journey through Luke, we established that our time in this book study would yield two answers, two specific questions, two answers. Number one, who is Jesus? And number two, who are we as his followers? The four men, the friends who had likely heard of Jesus, maybe even had been a part of the crowd of followers, knew that Jesus had the power to heal, and they chose to bring their friend to him. Being unable to get through the crowd, be it that the crowd was too large or even that the crowd didn't want anything to do with this lame man so they wouldn't part the way and let him in, the friends decided they still would get him to Jesus no matter what. Those three words I intend to repeat over and over, so stay with me. No matter what, they got him to Jesus. And rather than simply make him able to walk again, the first words from Jesus are, "Friend, your sins are forgiven." In Luke 5, we see four different examples of how Jesus cares for people. The first, we see him call laborers to join him in ministering. The second, he heals a leper. That was what we read just before we jumped into our passage this morning. Thirdly, he saves a man from his sins, and then he changes people's lives if you keep reading and you read about how he called Matthew. So, this morning, if you were to ask the question, in light of all of this, the fact that he cares about people, the fact that he is performing miracles, the fact that he is calling people to join him in ministry, the fact that he would heal a man's or forgive a man's sins, the fact that he would heal his physical ailment. If the question is, who is Jesus? The answer is very simply, Jesus is fully God.
Yes. Amen.
You see, Jesus isn't just another prophet. Jesus isn't just another teacher. He's not just another one of the world religion folks that we should be paying attention to. Jesus is fully God and fully man.
Amen.
To walk down that rabbit trail for just a minute, I can take you to the graves of each individual religious leader that you ever wanted to imagine. But at the end of the day, I could also take you to a very empty tomb and prove to you that Jesus is fully God and fully man. Folks, we have hope today because we have placed our hope, our trust, our faith in Jesus Christ, who loved you enough to take your sins to that cross, who loved you enough to bear the weight, to bear the sin debt that you carried, and died in your place.
Thank you, Lord.
Was buried. Spent 3 days in a tomb, but according to that wonderful word of God and according to that song that we sing every year, up from the grave he arose. Amen? With a mighty triumph over his foes. You need a reason to celebrate this morning. You ask the question, who is Jesus? Jesus is fully God and fully man. And in our context of the Keck Church in 2019, the message that we have to share is that Jesus has the power to heal and to forgive. Notice, his first priority on that day was to forgive the man's sins. By faith, he came. By faith, they brought him. And because of faith, Jesus forgave his sins. But knowing that the Pharisees weren't happy about it, he healed his inability to walk to prove that he could and in fact did forgive the paralytic's sins. Perhaps there is no better story for us to study this morning, because the reality is, even in our villa team that's going out to wash laundry, that team has the opportunity to share with those folks about a man who cares for them enough that he can actually wash their sins away. You with me? The fact that we would have a team going out to a Methodist youth home to deal and to work with and to minister and to love on some at-risk teens to tell them, hey, Jesus loves you. There's nothing that you have done at any point in your past that could ever separate you from the love of Jesus. You with me this morning? There's nothing that you can do that's so bad that Jesus can't forgive you.
Thank you, Jesus.
You say, what about that team doing yard work? What about that team going and working on a fence? Well, as they're mending a fence, we can talk about how Jesus has the power to mend broken families, how he has the power to mend broken lives, broken hearts. got other teams that are going to Love on Children, having the opportunity to share with them wonderful songs that our children are already learning. Some of them they are learning actually with sign language so that they can communicate to those that are hard of hearing. I think it's wonderful when we see the people of God stepping up and saying, there is a message to share, and that is that Jesus loves you, and I know it personally, and so I want to share with you from my perspective so that you can hear a true life story. A very personal story that God loves you, and He loves you enough that He sent Jesus to die for you. These men loved their friend enough that they would stop at nothing to get him to the foot of Jesus. For us as a church, it should be no different. You hear me? There should be nothing that would stand in our way. There should be nothing that we would say, that's just a step too far. I'm pretty sure I just read in here that Jesus healed a man that had been dealing with leprosy. If you know anything about the Mosaic law of the time, he wasn't even supposed to pay attention to this man, much less touch him. With me? So as a culture, as a society, who are the ones that are deemed the untouchable? And are we going to allow our society to dictate those that we will carry the gospel to? Lord, I pray not. People need the Lord.
Amen.
We sing it regularly. People need the Lord. And if we have the message to share and yet choose not to, what does that say about us? If you were carrying the cure for cancer and chose not to share it with anyone, what would that say about you? Folks, what we are dealing with, the sin nature that each and every one of us carries, is far worse than anything cancer could ever dream up. The wages of sin is death. But the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. How can we not share it? How can we not look at those that society has said, eh, and say, let me tell you about Jesus? How can we not be excited about that? Notice these men didn't say, how dare you? Talking about those religious leaders. Look back at 22. Perceiving their thoughts. 21 says they were thinking, who is the man who speaks blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone? Perceiving their thoughts, Jesus replied to them, why are you thinking this? Small little tidbit there. Jesus knew their thoughts in much the same way that He knows our thoughts.
Amen.
And you say, Marshall, that's really comforting when it comes time for prayer. You're right. Because He knows the concerns. He knows what we're carrying. He knows our burdens. He knows our struggles. And He loves us and seeks to meet those.
Amen.
But there's a flip side. He knows what's running through your mind when you get ready to minister to those that you would think would be the untouchables. Are you going to them with an open heart and open thoughts and open mind saying, I've got a message to share with you? Or are we going thinking to ourselves, I really don't want to do this, but the preacher said maybe we should, so I'm willing. There's a difference. And He knows our hearts. And He knows our minds. And He knows our thoughts. Charles Spurgeon offered the following in a sermon that he preached on this passage. There are cases which will need the aid of a little band of workers before they will be fully saved. By this he means, we see in this passage the efforts of the men who brought the paralytic to Jesus. In our context today, there may be some in this room that only met Jesus because somebody invited them to church. It could be that you only met Jesus because somebody cared enough to help you through a hard time in Jesus' name. It could be that you were saved because a seed was planted many years ago in vacation Bible school or in a backyard Bible club, and it wasn't until you were an adult that that seed actually sprouted and you surrendered your life to Christ. Or it could be that you're here this morning having never fully trusted in Christ as your Lord and your Savior. But hear me, you're not here by accident. You're not. In order for this lame man to be saved, it took the efforts of his friends to get him to Jesus' feet. Friends who would stop at nothing to get him there. Folks, that is love. And when Jesus was pressed, and with all of the commandments in the Old Testament, and that religious leader looked at him trying to catch him in his words, and he says, so, out of all of the commandments, which one's the most important? Which one's the greatest? What was it he said? Love God, love your neighbor. Check your heart this morning. Loving God is often easy, but loving your neighbor? Marshall, you don't know my neighbor. You don't know how meticulously I keep my yard, and you don't know about what his dog does whenever he... You don't know what kind of attitude I've been dealing with for years. You don't know how he treats me. You don't know how my coworker acts around me. You don't know the nasty things that people say about me, and you expect me to love them? I don't. Jesus does. Because the truth of the matter is, no matter how nasty and dirty you think those people have been to you, you've been the same way to Jesus.
Yeah.
And yet, he loves us anyway.
Amen.
The crux of the message found in verses 22 through 24. Jesus not only forgave the man's sins, but in order to give proof that he had done that, he healed the man and allowed him to walk. That's a very difficult passage to kind of take apart, especially verse 24. It's hard to read. So let me break it down just a little. There would have been no way for those that were in attendance that day to know whether or not Jesus had actually forgiven the man's sins. There's not. They couldn't see his heart. They couldn't see his soul. They would have had no way of knowing. Jesus knew that. And he said, since you're not able to know whether or not I really did what I say I just did, how about this? Get up and walk. And immediately, he did.
Amen.
Last point as we draw it to a close. Not only did the man get up and immediately go home, not only did he get up and walk, but notice there at the end, verse 25. He got up before them, picked up what he had been lying on, and went home, what? Glorifying God. Everyone was astonished, and they were giving glory to God. And they were filled with awe and said, "We have seen incredible things today." Last point, again borrowing from Spurgeon, all of this tends to lead to glorifying God.
Mm-hmm.
Everything that we're doing, every mission that we have identified and said we're going to start going out and doing today or for the youth home yesterday, there's not a single mission or a single ministry that has been designed so that folks would look at Keck and say, man, that's a great church. They all have been designed in order that folks would look at us and try to figure out what it is that makes us different, and then we have the chance to share the message of Jesus with them. It's not about the Keck kingdom, it's about God's kingdom, amen? It's not about us, it's about who?
Jesus.
Glorifying God. So let's bookend it with this. Matthew, Mark, and Luke all give an account of this event in Jesus' ministry. All three accounts highlight the friends that stop at nothing to bring their friend to Jesus. All three accounts highlight the scribes' evil thoughts. And all three tell us that when Jesus pronounced the man healed, he immediately got up and went. And all three of them say that it led to the glorifying of God. Would you bow your heads with me? As we prepare to launch our Keck Serve initiative this afternoon, I want to encourage you to pray for those who are going to be serving. Pray that God would begin to work in their hearts even now, that they might be receptive to the message that Jesus loves them and wants a personal relationship with them. Pray that God would bless our efforts for His kingdom's growth and for His glory to shine. But also, if you're here this morning and you fall into the category that I mentioned earlier, that you've come this morning by no mistake, but that you've come this morning having never trusted in Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, then I want to speak directly for you for just a second. Scripture is clear that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That means there's not one of us here that has not done something, that has not got sin in our lives that has separated us from a very righteous, very holy, very just God. And that passage of Scripture goes on to tell us that not only have we all sinned and fallen short of His glory, but it also tells us that the result of us having fallen is death. And I don't just mean that, you know, one day we're going to die, because we all will. We all will cease to live at some point. But that death that Paul describes there in Romans is an eternal death. That means that for eternity, the wages of the sin in this life will be that you are separated from God. But God loved us enough that while we were still sinners, He allowed for Christ to die for us. He sent His Son to do exactly that. And so this morning, if you've never trusted in Christ Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, please understand that He loves you. That He does have the ability, the authority, the power to forgive you of the sins in your life, to save you from that eternity in a very real place called hell. And if you've never turned your life over to Him, I want to invite you, as we stand and sing in just a minute, to do exactly that. I'll be standing down front and I'd love to talk with you. There may be somebody on your aisle, somebody that brought you this morning, or just somebody that you know personally, and they may be able to help you. And so you think to yourself, just talk to me. And so if you're not comfortable coming down to talk to me, I would encourage you to find somebody near you and say, tell me more about this Jesus fella. Because there is no greater decision that can be made than to make Jesus the Lord of your life. And understand that those four friends that carried their buddy on a mat to the feet of Jesus was perhaps the greatest act of love that you could find, because they knew that Jesus could heal not only the physical, but that He could heal the spiritual. Father God, as we stand and as we sing, I pray that Your Holy Spirit that has been flowing all through this day would continue to flow freely, and that we would respond obediently to whatever direction He leads us in. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Would you stand as we sing?
Come, come every soul, by sin oppressed, there's mercy with the Lord, and He will surely give you rest by trusting in His word. Only trust Him, only trust Him, only trust Him now. He will save you, He will save you, He will save you now. For Jesus shed